All right, guys, so what we've just found here is actually one of my personal favorites and a very, very interesting member of this sort of environment, if you will. So let's see if we can actually have a look. First of all, if you notice over here, it looks very inconspicuous. I'll actually clean away a bit here. Look at this. Looks like it could be an old tree stump. Maybe someone's trodden a little bit of animal dung there and squashed it into the ground. But this is actually a home to a very incredible animal. So let's see if anyone is home today. What you like to do is just have something just to try and get into this little gap. So we're not actually damaging this home at all, but there is actually, if you have a look just along the edge over here, there's a little room and you'll notice that you can get something into this room. Now I can already feel, feels like someone's locking the door. It was very rude of me, I should have knocked first. So you can actually get in and slowly but surely start to open up this amazing door over here. Look at that. Now already you can see that this particular creature has got babies, which is very, very cool. So what we're looking at here is a whole of what we call a trapdoor spider. So it's a member of the tarantula family. And what they do is when they're very, very young, this sort of size, they'll leave the hole. They go and they dig their own little hole and they line it with web and soil and they keep it perfectly cylindrical, as you can see, and they build this perfect little trap door. They've got these little holes in the roof that they can grab and shut the door after them, and they'll stay in this hole for their entire life. So let's see if there is anyone home. Now, what is very interesting is as they grow, they actually DIY and they build their houses, build their holes as they grow. So being part of the tarantula family, they are very long lived. Some members of the tarantula family can live over 20 years. So spider like this, 15 years, no problem. And all in the same hole, which is quite incredible. So for all of those at home thinking that a couple weeks of lockdown is tough, imagine spending your entire life in one little hole. But let's see if we can find anyone home. So you'll notice that on this little piece of grass, I just bit the end a little bit. And all that's gonna do is just allow this particular critter to be able to bite on and hopefully come out to say hello. Now the babies are a good sign because mom will typically still be around with them. We just got to feel until we can feel a little bit of movement. You can see some of the babies already starting to leave the web, leave the nest and start their own little journey. There we go, she's biting. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Cool. So small one nonetheless, but I say they do get to about the size of my hand. So this is what we call a trapdoor spider. They say mainly just because of the actual trapdoor lid itself, but you can see just by the size of it, what we call a ground dwelling spider. So spiders are broken up into two different groups depending on if they make a web or if they're ground dwelling. Your web making spiders, what we call araneomorphs, actually in reference to their mouth parts, how their mouth parts move sideways. Your tarantulas, a lot of your ground dwelling spiders, like your golden, not your golden orbs, your baboon spiders, they actually have these downward facing mouth parts itself. So if they actually capture a prey, typically much larger, they don't have as much venom as the other species. So they've actually used their size to overpower the prey. They've got this massive set of fangs, very, very soft and silky, but if we actually lift up these front little legs, you can see her fangs on the front over here, massive fangs. And a spider this size, when they do get a bit bigger, anything from the larger range of insects, crickets, locusts, even small frogs, up to a small mouse, depending on the size of the spider itself. What we look for is we want to identify between male and female when it comes to these guys, is to actually look at their rump itself. You find the females typically have quite a big rump, and the male's rump will be half the size of that. The abdomen itself will be half the size. Males also have slightly longer legs. They tend to be a little bit more nomadic, so they'll actually go off in search of females, find a hole with a female in it. They've basically got a signal to her that they are a mate, not food. They'll have a bit of a mating process. He'll actually then go off on his own and leave. So you can then see she'll lay her eggs inside, the eggs will hatch, and eventually over time, the little youngsters do start coming out on their own accord, completely on their own accord, to actually go and start their little lives. They'll dig a little hole of their own, and if they're females, they'll stay in that hole for the rest of their life. and basically just adapt it and grow it as we go. So they are ambush hunters, and they got little threads of silk that run all along the tunnel here itself, and they can actually feel vibrations of animals walking past. That's an elephant, that's too big. A little mouse comes past, that's perfect. Open up the door, launch out, grab it, and pull the animal back in. They'll subdue it with those fangs, chew the venom in, but the venom basically isn't really to kill the animal. It's more to liquidize the insides, so the insides turn to mush, and actually makes it something that the spider is actually then able to consume. So in terms of being venomous, all spiders are venomous. It's one of the things that makes a spider is actually having venom sacs. But these guys are not venomous to the extent of actually causing any harm to humans. In Southern Africa, it's not actually the biggest spiders you have to worry about in terms of being venomous. It's actually the little spiders. So we've got about 6 different species all around the size of your pinky nail, your black buttons, your violins, those sort of spiders that can actually cause a lot of harm. These guys have their size. So they use the size to overpower their prey. Their bite to us will basically be like a bit of a bee sting, burn for a little bit, but really nothing severe. You don't have to seek any medical attention. And it really is just their size. They use their size to overpower. As I say, inject their prey, chew it in, and actually then liquidize it. They're then able to then consume that. And often in the bottom, they actually leave all the little components, all the old exoskeletons and that of things they have been eating. And every now and then they'll actually come and take like a bit of a web out with all the exoskeletons, the old egg casings, and actually go and leave it, basically clean the house out, if you will. Take any rubbish out and actually leave them. And you often find on the outskirts the old nests and the old exoskeletons from this very clever lady actually cleaning her house as she goes. All right, now we don't want to leave her out of the hole. She is primarily nocturnal, so she does all of her hunting at night. And there's a good reason for that. So two of her biggest enemies, funny enough, are ants and baboons. So baboons will actually come along and they'll dig up the hole, completely dig up that entire tube, and actually eat the spider itself. It's quite a good form of protein. But as we showed you with the size of the fangs, she eats things on the larger scale of insects. So something like a little ant, she actually can't bite. She can't physically bite onto it. And the ants will actually swarm and kill her. So it's very important to not only get her back in, but to make sure that we seal up the hole again properly afterwards so no ants can come in. Saying this as well, we've kept a bit of a look around the area, haven't seen any ants coming in, but in previous times that we have done this experiment, we've actually watched the little youngsters come out and walk in between ants as the ants are coming towards the hole to actually try and swarm the female. We've actually seen the little youngsters coming out and walk in between the ants and carry on their way. So they're completely oblivious to the ants at their size, but once they do get big, they become a prime food source for ants in particular, who will swarm them and then actually take over the nest itself. So what we're going to do is we're going to get it to try and bite back onto this piece. If not, we'll get a slightly smaller one. Come on, old girl. She's got these little hooks on the end of her feet that actually hook onto, you can just see them over there, that actually hook onto the door to actually help close them. And those little hooks, along with the fangs, are what we're going to try and use to neatly slip her back in. She's going to play ball today. Come on, old girl. You can walk her back to the tube. You'll see once she's actually in the range of her hole, and she knows it, watch what she's going to do. So once she knows she's safe, see how she actually curves herself in. And off she goes. Now, typically she will close the door behind her, but obviously we've caused a little bit of a disturbance. So she's just trying to retreat. So we're going to close that hole up nicely like so. And what I actually like to do is just to take a little bit of extra dirt and just rub it into the edges there. She's still able to push it back up again, but we've sealed her in safe, and a couple of her youngsters are on their way to start their own lives in their lifetime lockdown, if you will.